Welcome back, my fellow seekers. Today I'm at Poverty Point Mounds in Louisiana, the second largest mound, second to Cahokia in East St. Louis, Missouri. Now, what's interesting is this mound's actually considered to be one of the oldest mounds, at least 3,000 to 4,000 years old, and possibly older, because there's been cases with other mounds around here that are actually even older, supposedly. Now, also what's interesting is that Cahokia is known to have a stone chamber. It is yet to be known if this mound has a stone chamber either in the center or at the complete base of the mound. Now, this mound is quite eroded relative to the one in Cahokia because it is older. Now, if there is a stone chamber in here, it would be very interesting to know if there is a Nephilim giant, as I talk about in my other videos. A Nephilim, or what I call maybe the Aryan race. Not white people, but an actual giant humanoid race that was between 8 to 9 feet tall that many Native American legends and even other cultures have talked about. So it'll be interesting to know if there are any in here, but it's highly doubtful, but you never know. And I'll go over some of the legends on that. So let's learn a little bit more about this site and about the legends and see how that may connect with Atlantis. Now, as you can see, the platform right here is quite low. Right now the mound is about 72 feet tall from the top, but archaeologists think at one time it was probably 100 feet tall and a lot steeper. But due to burrowing of animals and insects and people taking soil away and farmers kind of flattening everything around here, it really slumps down the mound. And this is a very heavy rain area in Louisiana, so the erosion rate is actually quite higher. So that means that this mound probably doesn't have too much longer to live. Maybe another couple hundred years to 1,000 years if people don't maintain the right kind of grass on it. But the platform you can see was probably a platform where they had either huts for more the elite members of the town, which just had at least 5,000 people. Or the platform was also a gathering space where the chieftain, the high priest, would go to the very top and actually summon supernatural creatures. The idea of a shaman or priestess or a priest, they would do this. And in cult circles, we understand that this ability to summon actual supernatural creatures, aka UFOs, is quite possible. And that's probably what they could have been trying to do here. Now, in most cases, they probably weren't able to summon them, but they tried. They knew this secret knowledge, the chieftains, that you could do some kind of ritual to appease the gods, to bring them down. And that's the idea. And maybe thousands of people gathered on this platform. And then he would try to summon a UFO, I guess, or supernatural creatures, angels and demons, a orb of light could try to come down. And can you imagine how that would really shock the people and, you know, gather them together? And the chieftain would have so much power in this ability to summon, which I too have tried before, and it does work, but it takes a lot of time and patience. So back in the ancient times, they probably were aware of this as well. So it's something to keep in mind. It's just not just a ceremonial mound, but it's actually a functional use in the sense that they really were trying to get the attention of supernatural creatures in this sacred space. Now again, you can see that there's quite a bit of erosion here. Most likely, farmers would actually gather soil from here and use it for their farm fields because the soil is probably fertile. And the way the Native Americans built this is they actually would layer the soil with different types of soil and then they would compact it. Now, it's not sure if they used rocks or some kind of reeds or stuff to kind of really compact it together, but it looks like in this case, most of it is just one type of soil, but they would layer it in different compaction densities is one technique. But you can see it's quite a bit of road. This would have been filled in with soil, so it's hard to say where all that soil went. But we'll go up to the top.
So the layout of Poverty Point was clearly a master plan by a chieftain and his architect. Now, some say it was once a complete circle, but this is unlikely due to Poverty Point being situated right at the edge of the alluvial plain, so it was elevated at least 25 feet up. Now, it is possible there was a crescent-shaped mound on the other side of the river, which could complete Poverty Point's layout as an abstract bird, similar to how we depict the Air Force symbol. When we look at Google Earth, we see a depression of what may have been a mound, a crescent mound, but due to flooding and farming, it has been completely flattened. This may have been the tail, with Mound A being the head of the bird, and the crescent berms, where the huts resided, were the wings. Poverty Point is also aligned to the rising and setting sun, with the setting sun at the head of the abstract town layout. Other mounds are placed outside the features and were aligned to an axis mundi and reflections of solar bodies.
I also want to point out that there were trees all over this mound. Actually, even back in the 90s and the 80s, there were definitely trees all over here. The trees were sort of protecting the mound, but at the same time, when the trees get too big, those roots are just pushing the soil out from below, and this is a very saturated ground being in Louisiana near the Mississippi. So yeah, these at one time small trees would have been good to hold the soil, but the bigger the trees get, the more they push that soil down. That could explain some of the slumping from the steps here too. Just the roots are making cavities and they're rotting, and now little burrowing animals are getting in there and adding to the soil. So yeah, I think at one time this was probably more the shape was more defined than it is now. And that could explain, but now they want to say it was a bird shape, but I don't think so. As I said, that I think this could be actually the head of the bird, and the whole site is an abstract form of the bird, an eagle or a falcon, a very abstract style, just to make it more practical to make a mound site, because it would be pretty complicated for them to really do a very defined feature of a bird. Take a lot of extra labor, so. Yeah, so one thing to keep in mind is, yes, there were trees here and they were pushing that soil out, and that's adding to the slumping, and over time it's spread out.
Now, the main part of the monument is the six concentric C-shaped ridges. Each ridge is separated from the next by swales and a gully. The ridges are divided in four alleys forming an earthwork sectors. Three additional linear ridges or causeways connect earthen features in the southern half of the ridges. Today, the ridges are only between 0.3 and 6 feet tall, relative to the adjacent swales. Archaeologists believe at one time these were at least 6 to 10 feet tall, but have been worn down through over 150 years of agricultural plowing and erosion. The slightly rounded crests of each ridge varies from between 50 and 80 feet in width. The width of the intervals of the swales is between 65 and 100 feet. The approximate diameter of outside ridges is 3/4 of a mile, while the innermost ridge's diameter is about 3/8 of a mile. The scale of the ridges is so massive that it wasn't until researchers examined aerial photography that they were able to recognize the geometric design.
Now, this is the space where the crescent-shaped mounds would be, and these would have actually huts on them. People would live here, and probably the more the elite members of the different tribes would come and gather here. Now, right now, archaeologists don't want to claim that this was an agricultural society, but I think it could have been. So this was the main plaza, where kind of like the market gathering and people come together, and probably dozens of huts would have been settled here at one time, and the river is in that direction. Now, I'm here at the Cattle Mounds in East Texas. Now, this site is not as old as Poverty Point, but the technology level would have been about the same as Poverty Point, even though Poverty Point is thousands of years older. This site dates to about 1,500 years old. Could be possibly older. And again, whether the size of the mountain matters if these giants were between 7 and 8 feet tall, you know, you don't need necessarily a big mound. There could be some way down deep in this mountain. They have excavated a few of these mounds, but they only excavated to about the base, but they did excavate below that, so possibly there could be more way below this mound. And the curator here was telling me that even at the cattle mounds, they have legends about cannibals. Now, they didn't necessarily say they were giants, but there's this idea in a lot of Native American legends about these cannibals that would actually eat Native Americans, apparently. Whether this is related to the giants and Nephilim is hard to say, but it's something to keep in mind. So at the cattle mound site, this gives you kind of an idea what their agricultural kind of plats would look like. So they would have their thatched houses right here, and then the gardens would be kind of fenced in and be about this size. So maybe about 50 feet to 50 feet for each little house, or maybe even possibly larger. So this gives you an idea. Now this, the one that was here was destroyed by a tornado. So makes you wonder how many of these actually have been destroyed by tornadoes in the ancient past. But yeah, this gives you an idea of the size of the plot. So it's kind of nice. You got a little kind of house here, and you got your garden, you would work around it. So kind of a nice little setting. And there would be literally at least a couple dozen of these little houses all around the cattle mound site.
Another interesting earthwork at the cattle mounds is the burrow pits where they did some of their cut and fill. Although this bowl-shaped pit only accounted for one-third of the volume of soil that they moved in for the three mounds. What's interesting is that they did the cut and fill right in front of their main docking area where canoes would come in and trading goods would come in along the stream, which acted like their highway. They also had extensive trail system that may have connected to Poverty Point. These trails led to smaller family villages where they would borrow canoes to the next trailhead or village. So this pit in the shape of an elongated bowl may have also been used as an amphitheater for activities, more maybe informal activities, where the formal activities and ceremonies would happen on the platforms. For there seems to be some stones on the steep end where it could have been used as a retaining wall or maybe like a terracing system for a seating place. At one time, they may have also used the logs as seedings, because this area is filled with little fire ants, so they would have to have some kind of seeding system. So those trading in goods from the stream would enter into this grand amphitheater shaped from the cliffside. As they climb up the stone steps to the top, only then they would be able to see this urban town of 353 acres and 600 people with its three main mounds, to send a clear message that we are the descendants of the great confederation of tribes that came out of Cahokia and Poverty Point. So let's learn a little bit more about Poverty Point. The whole site is about 345 acres. Now the area where the visitor center is located and where Mound C, or Dunbar's Mound, is the plaza area where possibly more huts for the lower class were situated and where merchants would set up their spaces to sell or barter their trading goods that came from the river. Beads and ornamentation may have been used for currency. Now where there's grass was once a large dirt plaza that was raised a few feet. This area was still more prone to flooding, whereas those living on the berms had the privilege of not being on saturated grounds. It's also possible that the swales may actually have had water in them as a landscape feature and functional use, but most likely did not connect to the river. But the berms did extend to the river. The soil was gathered from these depressions as you see on Google Earth, where now it has become a marshland. And I do think sleds and baskets were used in transporting the soil, and I would not rule out the possibility that they actually domesticated some bucks or deer to pull these sleds, but the majority of the labor was still done by people. Archaeologists want to argue that Poverty Point was just a hunter and gatherer town society, and I don't disagree with that, but I do think they had traded in a staple crop. But not maize, but instead I think it was rice and beans that was grown in the alluvial plain by many small plots of land scattered throughout the floodplain. To this day, Louisiana and Arkansas are the top producers of rice in North America because the land is just right for it, although it was wild rice and Mexican rice that was probably grown, but it may not have been the most important staple food because they are situated right on the river, and they had many trading goods that were brought into Poverty Point as a tribute tax. So scattered throughout the floodplain, there were many little farm huts that had garden patches. Each year, a bushel of seeds may have been brought to Poverty Point, but due to these patches of farmlands being in the floodplain, most of the ovens could be rotted away. because we're not talking about large farm fields, but instead little garden patches of maybe 100 feet by 100 feet. So if there's any archaeological evidence, it would be east of Poverty Point, because west was the dense woodlands. Most likely, the agricultural knowledge came up from Mesoamerica and entered through the Mississippi north, giving birth to the Mississippian cultures. If Poverty Point is at least 4,000 years old, then most likely Mesoamerican cultures are even older. Now, I think Poverty Point is probably older because sites like Watson Break, just west of Poverty Point, dates to around 3,500 BC. There seems to be an inconsistency on the dating and level of sophistication of the mound sites and the artifacts. So I would put a margin of error of these sites being older by about 2,000 years. What they may be dating is the last heavy use of the site until its abandonment. Poverty Point itself seems to be lacking a lot of artifacts for such a large site, which makes me think that many of the artifacts were repurposed to other sites like Watson Break, just another tribe federation of the larger Mississippian Empire. So if 3,500 BC is the start of the Mississippians, then migrants from Central America settled following the Mississippi northward and spreading out, until this loose confederation of tribes fragmented into warfare, marking the end of the Mississippian Copper Age. Not a golden age, but a copper age that has long rusted away. So I think at one point, Poverty Point did create primitive metal tools, but that technology was lost after the collapse of the Mississippian Empire, which may have been part of the de-evolution since the fall of Atlantis in Egypt. So we're now on top of the mound, and can you just imagine if there, at one time, 4,000 or 5,000 years ago, a chieftain right here might have been doing some kind of blood sacrifice and trying to actually summon a UFO. Now, do you need to build a giant mound to do a, summon a UFO? No, I've done it before. It does work, just takes a lot of time and meditation. Wouldn't recommend it though, because it is very creepy, but I wouldn't be surprised if the ancients understood how to do it, and by creating this mound, you're reinforcing the idea of the sacred summoning space. And up here may have been also a hut as well. There could have been a chieftain, the main chieftain hut up here, or maybe the council kind of gathered together for the town council, and where the you would see dozens of huts, if not dozens of huts out here of people living in there. So it's a pretty interesting thing. And also just contemplating whether there's a stone limestone chamber underneath here. Now there's not much stone in Cahokia, but they were known for trading a lot, so that's why some speculate that they didn't have agriculture, because maybe they traded in the agricultural goods, because they definitely got stone from Arkansas. So it'll be very interesting to find out way down below the main base of this pyramid mound if there really is a stone chamber, and maybe there could be a Nephilim giant. Who knows? But it's hard to say if archaeologists will do another scan, because on ground penetrating radar can only do so much when you have the little roller thing and there's so much soil on top. The way they did it in Missouri was they took a rod and they just stuck it down as far deep as they can get, and they eventually hit some stone. So that was my trip to these two mound sites. In part 2, we will get into the speculations on the Nephilim and my ideas about the legend, and how my opinions have changed after doing some more research. This has been Enigma Seeker. Keep seeking those enigmas.
Enigma depravation.